Most of us know this. Life can change in a heartbeat. Without any advance notice, things can be radically forever altered. When I wrote this, it was a couple months ago, on Wednesday, February the 14th, Valentine's Day, the community of Parkland, Florida was forever changed. The students at Stoneman Douglas High School were celebrating Valentine's Day in a variety of ways that Wednesday. Some were holding parties, and others were giving away or receiving helium balloons. School was about an hour away from dismissal. About 2:30 in the afternoon, shots rang out. When the shooting was over, 17 people lost their lives in another horrific school shooting. One of our neighbors, when we lived in the Meadowcrest Estates in Richland, had moved to Parkland a few years back. The wife is a cousin of Jen Mock, who attends here, who's our Vacation Bible School director. Their daughter was a student at the high school. I believe she was a freshman. She lost some very dear friends in the shooting, and I was able to reach out to the family, but they assured me they were being well taken care of. And as we can only imagine, it's been an extremely draining time, physically and emotionally. In such times, words are inadequate. We've also had, just this past week, another shooting in Santa Fe, Texas, where 10 people lost their lives. And in those times, words are inadequate. There's no rational explanation for things like that. There's no rhyme or reason to them. And people ask all kinds of different difficult questions. Where was God when the shooting took place? Why did so many innocent young people and public servants have to die? Why didn't God stop it? Why didn't he prevent it? And those types of questions are not easy to answer, at least in a manner that will satisfy the one asking those questions. I know this: God is not the author of evil. God didn't pull the trigger. I also know that God can take this senseless act and he can bring something good out of it. What was meant for evil, God is able to redeem. Those events on Valentine's Day in Parkland, Florida, and the events this last week in Santa Fe, Texas, certainly didn't catch God by surprise. But only God knows the end of the story. And only God knows any good that can ultimately come from such situations, albeit perhaps far down the road. I want you to know this morning. God has a heart for children. His heart grieves when lives are taken in places like Littleton, Colorado, Benton, Kentucky, Sandy Hook, Newton, Connecticut, Parkland, Florida, and Santa Fe, Texas. There's something we ought to be reminded anew when such incidences happen. Our children are a gift from the Lord. We should treasure them. I love the Angelus prayer. Not take them for granted. Not view them as an inconvenience or a nuisance. I'm reminded of Jesus' words in Matthew chapter 18, verse 5. Whoever welcomes a little child like this in my name, Jesus said, welcomes me. Then he offered a solemn warning in the very next verse, Matthew 18, 6. If anyone causes one of these little ones who believe in me to sin or stumble, it would be better for that individual to have a large millstone hung around his neck and to be drowned in the depths of the sea. Jesus loves children. And those who harm children will ultimately answer to him. We know this. It's a vastly different world now. Sometimes I'm convinced that we who are adults fail to understand the kind of world that our children face on a daily basis. Things have changed, and in big ways. Kids grew up in the 40s with World War II, Frank Sinatra, and Bogie and Bacall. If you don't know who that is, look around and ask someone you think might know, but be careful. Be careful. Kids in the 50s, wow, black and white TVs, grew up with the slogan, "I like Ike." It's not Ike Taylor, the Steelers. Hula hoops and good old Elvis Presley. In the 60s, it was the Beatles and LSD, Vietnam, and riots and violence in the streets in the major cities. In the 70s, it was Charlie's Angels, Saturday Night Fever, disco, the Doobie Brothers. In the 80s, it was crack cocaine, AIDS, MTV, Pee Wee Herman, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, and a thing called Nintendo. The 90s introduced The Simpsons, South Park, internet chat rooms, and Marilyn Manson. It is a drastically different world out there. Is it harder to raise kids today? Consider this. I believe it's listed in your bulletin. In the 1940s, public school teachers reported the following as the top five student-related problems: running in the hallways, chewing gum, wearing improper clothing. That meant having your shirt tail out. Making too much noise, not putting paper in the wastebaskets. You can see the same lists by public school teachers in the 80s. Assault, personal theft, burglary, drug abuse, robbery. Times have definitely changed, and not always or necessarily for the better. Our kids see more, they know more, they experience more, and they grow up much faster. I love the words of James Dobson, the founder of Focus on the Family. He said this: "We must make the salvation of our children our number one priority. Nothing else is more important." Is that true of you? To be certain that your children have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. That represents a Christian viewpoint, placing a extremely high value on our children as being precious gifts from the Lord. With this introduction, we turn to the two Psalms that Angela read for us. They were placed together for a reason. They speak of happy domestic tranquility that seems far removed from the terror that struck Stoneman Douglas in Santa Fe. They teach us, these Psalms, how God feels about children and how our children can and should be a blessing, not a burden. You see in your outline that according to Psalm 127:3, children are a gift from God. Children come directly from the hand of God. Our children are the gifts of grace sent down to this earth from heaven. The Bible tells us that God takes personal responsibility for the creation of life in the womb. In Genesis 30:18, it says, God listened to Leah, to her prayers, and she became pregnant. Genesis 33:5, Jacob is speaking, and he said, The children God has graciously given your servant. Moving on in Genesis 48:9, Jacob again speaks and says, the sons God has given me. When Moses was speaking to the Israelites in Deuteronomy 7:13, he said, He, God, will bless the fruit of your womb. And Psalm 139:13 says, for you, that's God, you created my inmost being. God, you knit me together in my mother's womb. The next time you want to feel low self-esteem or feel inadequate, remember God made you. He made you unique. He formed you in your mother's womb. That tells us life begins at conception. That tells us that God alone has the right to take a life. That tells us that abortion is morally, ethically, spiritually wrong. That doesn't mean we should beat up the person that's had an abortion, but we should love them with the love of Jesus. Children, the Bible says, are a special sign of God's favor. Instead of building empires, parents should be concerned about building a family. Children are a heritage, Psalm 127 says, from God, a way of preserving the family into the next generation. And all of us naturally want to be remembered long after we're gone. If you're a parent, you will be remembered by the children you leave behind. And that legacy will remain long after your personal achievements have been forgotten. And here's the fact. Sometimes couples can't have children for a variety of reasons. And I want to point out to you that our text in Psalms does not say the inability to have children is a sign of God's judgment. It simply says there that children, if you have them, they are a blessing from God. It's imperative, it's vital that we teach only what the Bible says, and we don't try to go beyond that. You say, what about those couples who desperately want to have children but cannot? I've witnessed such couples become surrogate-type parents to the children around them, especially to the children who have less than ideal or perhaps absentee parents. Those that are unable to have children are often the ones who minister to the fatherless and the motherless. And often these individuals adopt children. They serve as foster parents. They work in a crisis pregnancy center. They tutor children. They teach in the children's ministry. And they reach out to at-risk children. And here's the sad reality. There are many children who have no one who genuinely loves and tenderly cares for them. God bless those adults who show the love of Jesus to the children of the world who so deserve. It is a joy that is perhaps unequaled to watch your children grow up so much like you. They're made in your image, a miniature you, yet so very different. Often they walk like you. They talk like you. And yet we know this as parents. They definitely have a mind of their own. No one can be said to have lived in vain who leaves behind children who know and love the Lord and follow in His steps. If your children know the Lord, love the Lord, and walk after Jesus, you haven't lived in vain. One of my favorite verses in all of Scripture is in the brief book of 3 John. 3 John, there's only one chapter, verse 4. John said this, I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in the truth. Does that accurately describe your parenting philosophy? Is it your top priority as a parent to see your children come to know Jesus Christ as Savior and follow Him as the Lord of their life? Children bring God's love to us. It's been said, and I think rightfully so, there are no atheists in the nursery. When you look closely into your child's face, you will know and understand that only God could have done this. Only God could have created this life. And your doubts will then vanish like the morning mist in the summertime. Time and eternity meet in the heart of a child. Each and every child comes bearing the fingerprint of God. If you read the Gospels, the Lord Jesus loved little children, and so must we. Moving on in your outline, you see that children, according to verse 127:4, they're like arrows that need to be sharpened and aimed. An arrow is a small but extremely powerful piece of weaponry. Think what our children can do. An arrow must be sharpened well. So must we as parents shape our children. An arrow is able to travel far. Who knows how far our children can and will go in life? An arrow must be properly aimed to hit its intended target. Moms and dads, let me ask you, what target is it that you're aiming at? What is it that if somebody said, what is it that you as a mom or dad want your child to become more than anything else? Let me ask you, is it your number one priority that your child become a sold-out follower of Jesus Christ? Serious archers spend countless hours preparing their arrows. They carefully select the proper wood or metal. They cut it precisely to size. And then they spend hours polishing and shaping and fitting the feathers and the arrowhead together. And they carefully aim their arrows because they understand that a misguided errant arrow can do great damage. Let me share a statement made over 100 years ago. Parents must not trifle with their kids like idiots with sharp tools. Don't trivialize your time with your kids. Don't treat them as trite or as insignificant. Too many parents are either absentee or they're failing to step up to the plate when it comes to guiding their children and being really and properly engaged in their children's lives, invested in their children's lives. And then these same parents wonder why their child is struggling in life. One youth pastor observed, too many parents are playing defense with their kids when they should be playing offense. Playing defense means hoping your children, well, I hope they won't smoke or drink or do drugs or have sex. I hope they won't get into any kind of trouble. As good as that may sound, that's setting the bar far too low for Christian moms and dads. As parents, we ought to make it our prayerful aim to raise our children to play offense, to raise our children to be world changers, to make a difference in the world for Jesus Christ. Sometimes our dreams for our children are too small. We think about our children. We say, here's what I'd like for my children. I want them to get a good education. I want them to secure a high-paying job. I want them to settle down and marry some nice person. And I want them to move out of the house. Let me tell you, that's not enough. Do you honestly want your children to fall in love with Jesus and serve Him wholeheartedly? If that's what you want, it's not going to happen accidentally. You must sharpen them like arrows, and you must aim and point them in the right direction. Here's what Solomon, the wisest man who ever lived, said in Proverbs 22:6, start children off on the way they should go, and even when they're old, they will not turn from it. Point your children in the right direction. Teach them properly, and they won't depart. Listen, they may go astray for a time, but listen, if your children are not currently walking with Jesus, don't settle for that and don't say, well, I failed. Continue to pray for them. And if you taught them, remember this, they have a free will. Doesn't mean that you failed. Psalm 127:5 says that children are the strength of the home. This verse seems to teach that large families are a special sign of God's blessing. It says having your quiver full of children. And so you say, well, Pastor, how full was full? That's like asking how long is long hair. I don't know. Everybody has a different opinion of what long hair is. The Bible certainly doesn't specify you should have 3 children, 4 children, 5 children, 10 children, 1 child. But in every place it speaks to the subject, children are always a blessing, and many children are a sign of God's favor. Not all families in the Bible were large, but there were some that were definitely large. God doesn't mandate how many children a couple should have. It's been suggested that quivers are like shoes. They come in different sizes. Make it a matter of prayer to figure out what size quiver God has given you, and then ask Him to help you fill it up. Children were the biblical version of Social Security. They helped provide for their parents in their old age. If parents have loving children, they will be taken care of as they advance in age. Look at verse 5, and it says there about the city gate. That was the place, the city gate, where men of power and influence conducted business. It was also the place where wise men ruled and passed their judgments. Men would meet their adversaries at the city gate. A father with good children would have defenders at the city gate when he was falsely accused. His children would stand and testify to his good name. They would vouch for his character. They knew him well. Eugene Peterson renders that verse, "Your enemies don't stand a chance against you. You'll sweep them right off the doorstep." What he's talking about, the psalmist, is a family united to defend itself against attacks. And listen, the family will be attacked. Notice as you read that verse that there's nothing said there about money, about power, about status or position in life. I want you to understand that God's blessing is not seen in the accumulation of worldly possessions, but rather in a happy family that rallies around each other whenever trouble comes knocking. Let me offer a word to the workaholic mom or dad. What shall it profit a man or woman if he or she gains the whole world and yet loses his or her own family? If you're a parent, you know this, that raising children can and often is tiresome, demanding, difficult. I'm glad that our daughter, Mallory, is raised. We were on vacation together, the 5 of us. Some of you saw pictures. I don't go on Facebook. But the first night, Ashton decided he wanted to get up at 3 a.m. He's done sleeping. He wanted to eat breakfast. He was hungry. So good old dad got up. Grandma and Grandpa were in the other room. We had no clue of that. We were sleeping. It can be tiresome. It can be difficult. I think you could probably go on Facebook. There was a picture of Ashton eating breakfast with the moon out the balcony window. Now, tiresome. The greater your child's promise, the more challenging will be the task of raising them to be godly individuals. Reading on in Psalm 128, 3 and 4, we see that children are the hope of the home. When the psalmist talks about a vine, he's intentional. The vine is a symbol of charm and beauty and sexual appeal. The woman in this verse offers a marked contrast to the faithless woman. The faithless woman is described in Proverbs 7:11. Solomon says the woman without faith is unruly and loud and defiant. This unfaithful woman, this faithless woman, never stays at home. Conversely, in Psalm 128, the wife here is attractive and alluring and charming and faithful. Let me assure you that God's ideal for a marriage is not that it be an endurance contest. How you getting along? Well, we're tolerating each other. We're staying out of each other's way. We're surviving. God fully intends for his married children to grow happier and better and to thrive in their marriage, not just survive. He desires that the husband still find his wife appealing, alluring, attractive after 20, 30, 40, 50 years of marriage. And I can honestly say I find my beautiful wife, Sandy, very attractive after 37 plus years of marriage. And I do my best to communicate that to her on a regular basis. I'm proud of her. And I'm appreciative of the fact that she takes care of herself. She doesn't let herself go. The psalmist says the vine makes the house beautiful. The vine provides shade and enriches the table with ripe, delicious grapes. Thus is a godly wife to her husband. She is the crown jewel of her husband, who is in turn her support and strength. The husband is happy everywhere because he's happiest at home. When the psalmist talks about olive shoots, he's talking about the great potential that exists for the future. Mature olive trees produce fruit and wood and valuable oil. In the same way, the children given by God have vast potential for good in this world. No one can tell exactly what a child may become. I want to offer you six important conclusions. Number one, children are a gift from God, and happy families and homes are truly a great gift from God. Number two, God's blessing is available to anyone who prayerfully seeks it. Again, let me repeat that this is not a statement to say that God blesses people by giving them children and then he doesn't bless others by not allowing them or enabling them to have children. At this point, I'm talking about the fact that God desires to have his children have loving homes. Homes where there is mutual respect. Homes where Christ is the center. Having Christ at the center is much more important than accumulating material wealth. I could pray for you people that have made a lot of money. There was a man, relatively young, who said, Pastor, I made six figures last year, and basically I peed it all away. I don't have anything to show for it. I don't even know what I did with that money. His wife said, we have a beautiful house. We drive beautiful vehicles. We have a swimming pool. But I'd give all that away. We don't have a husband at home. We don't have a dad at home. That couple ended up divorced. Christ must be the center. People try to build on other things. They try to build on money. They try to build on possessions. They try to build on an all-out pursuit of hedonism, a pursuit of no-holds-barred pleasure. Whatever you want, whatever you see, whatever you desire, grab for it, because their motto is you only go around once in life, so grab for all the gusto you can get. They're building on unreliable foundations. Psalm 127:1 says, unless the Lord builds the house, they're laboring in vain that build. Third, we must recapture the high value of family, of monogamous marriage, of abstinence before marriage, and a happy life together after marriage. We must teach our children as parents that true love waits, that marriage is desirable and honorable. I cringe when I hear someone talking to people about to get married going, oh, I wouldn't do that if I were you. Don't do that. How would you like to be married to someone that's given that advice? Oh, you don't want to get married. I cringe when I hear that. Teaching our children that motherhood is a noble calling, that being a godly father is more important than being an executive VP or driving a BMW. that a loving family is worth more than all the gold in Fort Knox, that teaching our children that sexual promiscuity only leads to sorrow and heartache, and that all children, they're worth all the love and all the effort and all the investment of our time and our attention and our resources. Fourth, we must honor our fathers, our mothers, our grandparents, and our great-grandparents. But at the same time, we must be careful not to overlook or devalue those who have chosen the single life or who, for various reasons, cannot have children. Fifth, the church ought to emphasize the role that godly fathers play and the high calling of motherhood and being a homemaker. I believe that we are justified at West Hills Community Church in spending a considerable amount of money on our ministries to our children, nursery through adult. Our children represent the future of this church. That's why I get excited about this church, because you saw the little children up here. You see how many we have in nursery. We have a lot of young people in middle school, in high school. We have a healthy foundation. But these young people need to know Jesus. They need to love Jesus. Because all you need to do is look around at some of the churches across America, and there's a small gathering of gray-haired people, and that's it. You don't see any young people. You don't see anybody under 40. And in years down the road, that church is not going to exist if the trend doesn't change. Because God is, I looked out today, I saw the kids with the music. I want to know every child here and their names. There was a little boy here with a PennDOT orange shirt on, and he was rocking to the music. And I know Rowan, he was up here playing the box on the back of the pew. I love to see that. And I love the fact that God has entrusted us with young people. We get to partner with you, but it begins at home. We must continue to train our young parents in effective and godly child-rearing techniques. I would love for this church to establish a mentoring ministry where older couples who have raised their children can walk alongside our younger parents. Say, here, you want to know how to parent? Talk to these people. They've done it. And listen, they can tell you the mistakes they've made as well as the good things they've done. Fifth, we must continue to support our single parents, our foster parents. And we have those in this church. And there's a long list of single parents that I pray for on a daily basis. Our foster parents, our step parents, adopted children, and those in blended families. These folks need and they deserve our unconditional love and support. They need our prayers. Sadly, we live in a world that downplays the value of childhood, and a world that causes our children to grow up way too fast. It's never been easy to be a child, but today, the pressures are greater than ever. I am 100% convinced that happy families are still possible when God's word is taken seriously and followed obediently. We here at the church have the privilege of partnering with the Lord Jesus Christ in the building of our homes. And when we do that, our families will be blessed. Our children will prosper the way God wants them to. Our marriages will flourish. And Jesus Christ will be praised. And when our work on earth is done, we will be able to look back and say, God has blessed us beyond words with a happy Christian family. And because of that, we are rich. I am passionate about young people. I am passionate about family. I love kids. I love the infants, the toddlers. I coached middle school and high school. God bless the middle school teachers. I remember coaching them, getting on the bus and boys acting squirrely, singing with high voices just to drive the coach and everybody else in the bus nuts. And I can remember going to saying, I'm getting old for this stuff. And I said to her, if these boys, and I coached middle school girls too, if they could be videoed and see themselves in 4 or 5 years, they'd be appalled. They'd be like, what was I thinking acting that way? But I love young people. There's no greater reward. There's no better testimony. No higher goal for Christian parents than to invest their lives in their children. If we're able to say, God has blessed me with a godly child, we can go out of this world singing, knowing full well that we have prevailed in the area of life that matters most, raising our children to know and love Jesus. Moms and dads, do you know Jesus? Moms and dads, can you say that, yes, my children know Jesus? Yes, my number one priority is to know my children walk after Christ. Let us pray. As our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed, I want to ask you, do you know Jesus Christ as your Savior? Are you sure of that? If you do, then thank Him for that. Maybe you're here and you say, I don't know, or I know I don't know Jesus yet, but I want to. You can come to a personal relationship with Jesus by praying a prayer similar to this in the quietness of your own heart. Dear Lord Jesus, today, Lord, I'm going to own up to the fact that I am a sinner. And Jesus, I understand that You went to the cross of Calvary and took my sins on Your body, and You gave Your life, You shed Your blood to pay for my sin. Jesus, I'm sorry for my sin. I'm asking You to forgive me, to cleanse me. And Jesus, I'm opening my life to You, and I'm inviting You in to be my Savior today. And I want to follow You from this point on as the Lord of my life. So our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed. If you prayed that prayer today, just ask you to slip your hand. I'm not going to point you out in any fashion whatsoever. Yes, are there any others? Say, Pastor, I prayed. Moms and dads, grandparents, my prayer for you is that you will desire to follow Ephesians 6:4, that you'll bring up your children in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. I'm going to ask our moms and our dads and our grandparents to stand at this time. We're going to pray for them. So if you're a mom, a dad, a grandparent, if you'd stand, we want to pray for you before we sing a closing song. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank You for the awesome privilege that is ours to have children, to have grandchildren, to be invested in their lives. It is a privilege, but it's a tremendous responsibility too. Lord, one that we don't want to take lightly. We need Your help, Lord. And I pray for all our moms and our dads and our grandparents, Lord, that You fill them with Your love. And Lord, that You impress upon their hearts the need to model Jesus to their children and their grandchildren. And Father, I pray that You protect the homes that are here today, and that we be a light on the hill that we're going to sing about as we close. That others can look to the families here at West Hills Community Church and say, I wish our family could be like that. How do you do it? We do it because we're Christ-centered. Because Jesus is the foundation of our homes. Lord, we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to stand, all of us together. We're going to close with this song. Someone after the last service said this should be the theme song for our church, City on a Hill, or Light on a Hill. So Cindy's going to sing it, and you can join her.
see you.